D-BRAC meeting, the evening. First, we welcome everybody here. Thank you for showing up. I know it's a lot from the school. So many to know otherwise engaged. So what we're hoping to do tonight is if there is public comment. And then we are working on a draft of our guidance statement for the superintendent. So as we said before, the end of this phase of work will be guidance to staff and superintendent to not formal recommendation. And you've all received or have in your folder a draft copy of the guidance statement. And so what we'll be doing this evening is Jason will be walking us through the document. And then we'll spend a majority of our time in two different small groups, really focusing on what has been drafted so far, if we have alternative language to suggest, if this is reflective of our conversation, what we may need to add, and then we'll come together with you, the groups, and end by a discussion of what the reconvening of D-BRAC should look like next fall. So that's generally what we cover. First, the facility of through document review and the timing of the working session. And we'll brief the next steps and hopefully a little bit early.
Okay, so my understanding is that we do not have any public comment.
Heather,
okay. Like I said, we have some public comment. Okay, so why don't you state your name, the school that you represent, or the area that you represent, and 2 minutes for the 12 minutes.
I'm Heather Rossingham, Access PTA president, and I just, it's been very difficult for us to find the right place to advocate for our program. It's not really a boundary issue for us because we serve students from all over the district. More than 50 schools are represented in Access currently. 50 kids from 50 different schools, so we do, however, think that if the district is moving towards a K-5 model, and under enrollment at some of these K-5s is an issue in the North and Northeast cluster, that by leaving Access in place, growing our program at Idaho City Park, would not displace other students from their schools currently, would potentially provide the enrollment numbers needed to fill the buildings in some of the K-5s in that cluster, and provide room for our program to grow to serve the needs of students that are qualified, that are on the waiting list. And just a reminder, this isn't just a tag program. This is for students that test into the 99th percentile. This is a highly gifted, very unique population of students. And we have over 170 students qualified to attend Access on the waiting list from last year. I don't know what the numbers are going to be this year, so those are sort of the three key points, and just continue to reiterate, we need a central location because of where our students are coming from. We want them to grow to accommodate more of these special students. And we don't want to displace any other school. So, thanks.
Thank you. So, Jason? Culmination of not only the context of work that we've done so far, but we see what some of the next action items for us to look at and evolve as we head into the process next school year after looking at some areas. So what I'm going to do is walk through, we're just briefly giving you each kind of main piece of guidance that we just talked about or called out or identified on Saturday, give you the main points of what each piece is, and then after I explain one particular section of the guidance, I have some time reserved to take clarifying questions about what sort of care. After that, what we'll do is we're going to break into two groups that will be able to follow. We'll do a deep dive in the whole guidance section, figure out, did we accurately document what was discussed on Saturday? If we did, note that. If we didn't, please offer some proposed language that puts in alignment with what we discussed on Saturday. And there's some other issues that we're working on resolving. I think one of the things that we all know that as we're going through this time. So first part on the guidance section, which starts on page 5.
Jason, do you want to put it up here?
Yeah. First on page 5 is the discussion on where we have or potentially locate what we call two-strand or three-strand K5s. And this potential area discussion point came from the latter end of the meeting and was proposed idea by Joe. And so given the limited building stock that we have in Northland Northeast, I mean given the demographic trends and the goals and moment, Joe's proposal was when looking at the rate configuration of schools in Northland Northeast, that his proposal was partly to have more possible having three-strand K-5s, and given that we can't have that in all schools, given the number of students we have in that particular gradient, his proposal noted that we should prioritize locating three-strand K-5s in areas where there are high concentrations of either historically registered students or students who are low SES. And part of the rationale behind that proposal was because this gives the building high enough enrollment where it can generate not only enough programs, but as we've seen from Cascade, having a three-strand K-5 allows the building to be able to effectively absorb any enrollment fluctuations without seeing a significant impact on program access. This also would allow potential stability of programs for our high students and allow those programs to continue to be stable for a long period of time. So his proposal was, given the tension of wanting to have as many pre-strength K-5s as possible, but not having enough long to have that across North Northeast, that was his proposed change, a proposal there to address that issue. So for clarifying questions, or any clarifying questions on that, please, we offer the draft state of the year.
So my clarifying question is reading this is, does this mean pre-strand immersion only, or neighborhood only, or does that mean three-strand? I think you might need to clarify the language around, right now there's a lot of three-strand programs, but is it strand by program or is it strand by building? And I think the question is, do we need to clarify that? And I'll just leave that as a question right now, because I think it becomes addressed lower down, but you might need to clarify it higher up for
students, or in third grade students, fourth grade students, so there's two classrooms at each grade level in a school, and that's around 300 students.
What's a two-strand?
That's a two-strand, or if it's three, then there are three classrooms, and we use an estimate of 25 students equals a section or a strand classroom. We're using those interchangeably. If it's a three-section per grade level, that's around 450 students.
Do you have a clarifying
The, what do we call it? The chart that has the green and the yellow and red, the dot chart. I would like an explanation, and I've talked to Sarah about this, I'd like an explanation of what the assumptions are specifically for what school is a three strand or a two strand or whatever. I think that would be useful for the public as a whole, but I'd like to see what specifically those assumptions are, and also getting assumptions about, well, what would other rooms be used, or why does a X strand need this many more rooms, low poverty versus high poverty? I don't think that's in writing anymore. It is.
It's a long time ago.
We'll have to go back to the documentation we shared with you last fall.
Okay, is it up on the web?
I can't point you exactly where it is.
The web's.
You think they talk about this out there?
The web's been moved around a lot. Okay, and then when I look through this, I don't see the immersion strands that rest of all here.
They're not.
So we're gonna get out of this.
No, there is, I think that's correct.
So as I get there, we're gonna explain that's one of the areas where, as we were drafting it, I couldn't find a clear consensus on where we landed on, so part of the discussion is figuring out where did we in fact land on that side, so that's gonna be part of the discussion here, so we can get that accurately documented.
And I'm still unclear about whether, are we gonna plan around strands, or are we gonna plan around capacity utilization? I think it's unclear. As I read it, if we plan around strands, there's gonna be buildings that are have emptiness in them, because they weren't designed around current strands.
So if I understand correctly, you worked at the full band level? In that you have KPIs, key performance indicators that are both around program size, which is interpreted to mean the number of sections per grade level, as well as building capacity. So it's full band and not one or the other. If you can't achieve both, then you have to look to see how you can mitigate. But to date, you've looked at both. Maybe your question, and I'll check, but maybe your question, just for clarification, was whether D-BRAC is making a statement about prioritizing one of those over.
You train for the diplomatic corps. So my question would be, say, in fall, come to not only a configuration, but are we going to do the school three strand, the school two strand, and then draw boundaries to accommodate that? Or are we going to say 90% penalty? And there are going to be some differences and sometimes large differences between those two, I think. That makes a difference. So I'm not saying we're going to answer that right now, but it's unclear to me how we proceed on this one.
Do you want to respond?
Well, I think my question is related in that, when I think of the buildings as being a part of these trends, although there was mention in here about portables, I don't know if that was in that. I think it was mentioned in one of the meetings. But I think of the buildings as being determining whether a two or three strand program can fit. So then we've got this issue of, okay, so if we're trying to provide low SES schools, three strand schools, but three strand school doesn't fit in that building, particularly if there are immersion programs that are co-located, then we have to make decisions about ancillary, like we have to make decisions about the immersion programs and other things that might be happening in that building that might limit our ability to provide the strand program that we want to provide to that lower SES school.
trying to resolve some language tonight, but the brief is, where does the committee land on that set issue? A, do we want, based on the data report, and the way they were going to come on Saturday, what direction was the committee confident heading with regard to placement of emergency programs in the context of resizing the building? Is it either, do we want to have, building that is already doing the conversion, do we want to have the co-location staff waiting to give us the pros and cons of which, which can be optimized, and what the trade-offs are for that as part of the meeting on Saturday? So as part of that emergency discussion in the small groups, I think it would be really clear is that where we land on that, we have to think about that in the sense that we could do that discussion of both regular staff as well as the impact on each as part of the discussion on Saturday.
So I think my concern with the discussions at this point is that when I look around the room of D-BRAC members, there are four of us who are here, half group is here on Saturday and who has somewhat detailed level knowledge, and then half of the group that is not meant in any way pejoratively, but we're discussing something that has an antecedent that is unclear to half the people in the room. It was a really in-depth discussion. So I guess I just want to take a pause and consider how we move forward where things that may have seemed clear, may seem clear to Nation, Jason, Scott, and I see a bunch of lost faces because if you weren't participating in the discussion, there's a lot of information download and a lot of discussion in the next 6 hours. And so I don't want to know what to propose as the next step, but I just want to acknowledge that because it's a bit of an issue in our group right now. And so I guess I'm going to turn to you to help facilitate us through that.
So the question is, do you want to try and catch people up in the whole group, or do you want that to be part of when folks get into small groups, have that be the opportunity? So I'm going to leave that to co-chairs. Although, Scott, you have.
I think both are, because any one of us is going to have a
different.
And you know, you were.
Okay, Jenny has a thought about
it. So I apologize that I stepped away for a moment at the very start of the meeting, and maybe you did this and I missed it, but one thing that you might choose to do is just take a few minutes to read the notes from last meeting if you haven't yet, to read this 6-page document that's in front of you, to take a few minutes to reflect, and maybe you can come up with a good reflection question that will help get to that, and then come back to your discussion where then you're not introducing something that's truly new to people, and we can get right through clarifying questions, because that was the other thing, is I was helping engage in something that wasn't clarification, it was really discussion, valuable discussion, but not just clarification. So that may be one way. If you take 5-ish minutes to bring people sort of more to the common.
So my understanding is that the guidance document is how you're catching people up on that piece. You can go through by section with clarifying questions, which still begs the question that Pamela raises about part of the conversation that may be valuable to share. Scott has suggested that it take some time to do that for the whole group. So whom of you wants to do that?
So probably.
I'll start because Bill and Matt, because I'm just gonna hit. I'm just gonna hit highlights that I remember and stop me when I leave set up.
continue with what you're doing.
I think that what I was told is that we continue what we were doing, and then we get to the section that there's nothing written about, because of the way we divide the room. Then we go to people who are there to pause to discuss the part that there's no way to be there.
That sounds great. Okay, so we're back to clarifying questions for the first piece that Jason read. Any further clarifying questions? Okay, so now you're going to walk folks through the next piece and then set aside some time for clarifying questions.
Okay. The next piece, which was not necessarily kind of a called out discussion item, but one has come up a number of times in discussions that I really think about was important to get documented.
Yeah, when we're getting to small groups, that's going to be the opportunity to do that. Will be able to
how is that, how is the replacement applied to in consideration of where they live in their school? Are they being able to have a place of parking that is close to the school or any neighborhood school? And so, and given one of the things that we're calling out is because, you know, we have growing enrollment and we have number issues with the overcrowding buildings, that we have to, you know, think about what, you know, where's the long-term replacement of these programs? What's the best fit? Are we locating places close to the students on the best we can offer? And so while we do have a clear declarative statement that says, you know, students should be, must be able to stay at their place for growth and change, we're also, you know, drafting a caveat here to that thing, which says that, so while D-BRAC holds true that any student receiving a special education service must be able to remain at that particular school regardless of ground and change, D-BRAC offers one caveat. Only if the district can prove that by moving any special education service and those students receiving that service will only be an improvement to that student's ability to thrive in the school, D-BRAC may consider supporting the move in another classroom for purposes of this enrollment. So, we're acknowledging that these students need to be able to stay in their building, but the school at their place, but at the same time, if the only reason allows us to find a way to balance on the school, may be, you have to consider them as a special education classroom. The only way to directly consider them is if the district can demonstrate to us how the movement of that program into a different building is going to better serve that student that they're going to have. So we would only consider it if we believe the district can prove to us that it's in the best interest of the student and that the service would be improved in the school that they're going to need to. So that one was a tough one for D-BRAC, but it's just acknowledging the intention we've got of putting students first and then one for instance if we move as a benefit to them, then we could consider that.
Clarify question. I'm going to suggest that's going to be part of your small group conversations. Providing language that makes it clear and that's an agreement of D-BRAC. Other clarifying
questions? These are clarifying questions that I'd like to make sure get addressed in the group. Mm-hmm. So in addition to clarifying, so I want to make it like, so individual student placement decisions are made through an individualized educational plan. And it's not clear to me whether this is a statement about D-BRAC now wanting to be responsible for individualized educational plans. Because when you say the student, and D-BRAC wants to see proof that evidence that the student would be better served elsewhere, that puts you in a role that isn't necessarily typical for your committee at this point. So, that clarification would be helpful. additionally, if I'm reading that you want students who are receiving special education services should remain in their current school following a boundary change, does this apply as well to configuration changes? So, for example, if a building, if Rosebud Heights, there's a special education classroom that serves students in grades 6 through 8, and a classroom that serves students in 3 through 5. When Rosebud Heights converts to a middle school, are you saying that the kids in grades 3 through 5 should remain in that building, even after the reconfiguration? Because then they'd be the only kids in grades 3 through 5 in that building, and if students are affected by boundary, so generally anybody who's affected by boundary change can remain in their current school to the highest grade unless they're there for a specific program that moves right? So not because of boundary change. If a student wanted to go to their new neighborhood school and they received special education services, are you saying that they shouldn't be allowed to do that if they chose to? That's additional clarification that would be helpful. This just seems like an area that I hadn't heard a lot of discussion about in the last month or two. So I'm literally reading it for the first time. So I was a little surprised by some of the statements in there, and I'm just trying to process and make sure that I fully understand what the intent is and what your advice would be to the superintendent. Thank you.
So back to that respect, where this is coming from, a number of us found out this week that sped classroom and chat being moved to Hayes.
Yes, it is.
And from the outside, it looks a whole lot like chat is overcrowding to each other by moving to sped classroom somewhere else.
Thank you for making that clear. And I will try, I can't speak for the program team, but I have a little bit of information about it. It has to do with program delivery and decisions that were made on which grade levels will be served and how to have continuums together. So, but I wasn't a part of the decision making, so I'd be happy to get something back to you all, if possible, in writing by early next week and certainly before your next meeting. But I think that I can say that the decision to move a special education classroom for grades 3 through 5 that's in Chapman now to a different building is not because Chapman is overcrowded. It's not, that's not the reason. The reason is because it needs to be aligned with another classroom that now will be added into the west side. And it is true that there's very limited space to do that at Chapman, and space at Chapman continues to be likely to be a concern for the future. So there are a lot of questions about whether Chapman is a stable site to grow a program. But I will get your information about that.
You should
have
said that the program at Chapman.
And I think it was in 2008, special ed room was moved from Alameda to Chapman, and again, for community perception, I don't know if this is accurate, because that room, the other physical room was replaced by a first grade classroom, was that the room was needed for a first grade classroom, and I don't know what the background was, but that kind of thing has led people to believe that special ed rooms are being moved out of schools to make overcrowded.
I understand. I'm trying to get you information about the reason for the change.
Right. Yeah,
I get that. And I want to point out.
It's a perception issue.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
But I think what you also just said was that service has been in Chapman. And there were two classrooms. It was reduced down to one due to a program change a couple years ago. And now the program model is changing again. But that the program has been at Chapman for 8 years.
If it's the same room that used to be in Alameda.
I'm not sure if it is.
Yeah, and I don't know if
I'll try and find out for
you.
But I mean, I think that just because it could be a lot of things, but, and I understand if there's concern about this. I'm not taking it lightly. But I think I'm, as I said, happy to try and give you information about how long the program's been there, who it serves, why it's being moved.
We'll talk about this a little bit more later, but I think this for me brings up a question of the level of documentation in the document too. This document too, where it sounds like there's really two concerns that I'm hearing. So one is the comment that Scott brought up, that is, there's a specific, did boundary change cause an unintentional consequence of causing a special education classroom to move. And so to clearly document that we don't want to cause that unintentional consequence. So pretty high level statement. And then I'm hearing a level of questions about, you know, a specific instance or application. And so I just want to document those as sort of two different things. Like, so one is a response to community input, a community conversation about a specific instance, but also a higher level compliment of, are we comfortable making a statement about unintended consequences to this special education community that may cause a boundary change? And there's, to me, different.
I think you're right, they are two separate issues. There's the issue of when special ed classrooms are moved from overcrowded schools and replaced by regular classrooms, the assumption of the community is that the special education classroom was moved due to overcrowding. And then the second issue of how to, what happens when this boundary change to special education classrooms. So those are two actually extremely distinct issues.
So I just want to do a quick time check. Was your discussion that you're going to get into next about immersion, was that included in that 30 minutes? Because we're at that 30 minutes right now. So no, and I think we're still good on time. I just want to make that.
Well, I know that we did address this issue of special ed and the vulnerability and the need for stability for those kids in our values framework, but not very specifically, correct? Yeah. And so then, I think what we're saying is that the way this could play out if it was a value that was held highly would be that if overcrowding occurred, that rather than replacing the special ed classroom, you would adjust the boundary to address that overcrowding. And so that's, if it's not specifically spelled out in our values framework, our question now is, at this point, how do we pull that up as a value?
So I'm going to suggest that as part of your small group conversation. Right. So you'll have an opportunity to put language in to address that. One more.
I'm probably going to say the same thing I heard about Beth. I also think backing it up a step even further is, and I know that that Julie has tried various additional special education centers have various times, but it's also, as we talked about, underserved communities and equity, it's not only what exists, but what should be optimal, you know, so that students aren't having to not only be impacted now, but that there are sufficient resources across the district so that students that have these impacts can reasonably access them. And some special education students are served in the regular classroom, but the others aren't.
Okay, I'm going to suggest that we finish this piece, and so the next piece is immersion, or is this where you want to catch people up?
So the first one, we can do the same.
I think the one that the Get Me CLI program, Jason, and he can really walk us through that one, and the next two discussion ones that we didn't actually write down.
Okay, moving on to talking specifically about the BME's dual language learning program. So in that group, you're trying to balance both kind of the day of presentation that staff gave us, as well as acknowledging some of the kind of pieces of feedback that we got from the community. What came out of this and trying to find a long-term home for the dual language learning program with an identification of possibly three different school options. And listed in no particular order. One was Jason Lee. Given that his location, both Madison as well as near a high concentration of UNB's student language speakers. But Sarah Williams also had noted that it could happen at Lee. However, there would need to be
sessions per grade program co-located, that would put those two programs together, the building type one classroom space, and then the discussion group between looking at that one versus Vessel. The recognition was that you could do it, maybe with the option of, you know, having at least bringing one portable put in, because you wouldn't be able to accommodate that at Vessel, so that's why this is going here as part of this additional description. An additional point raised as part of the forward discussion was possibly locating it at Harrison Park PD. And that rationale was also based on the feedback that I got from O'Connor, which was a recognition that you could have it, you know, in northeast or southeast, but what the communities felt comfortable with was that so long it was located on the 82nd Avenue corridor, that provided reasonable transportation access for the families of current and potential. So the school site that's located in the middle between the two significant concentrations of these families that are out of northeast and out of southeast, so that location will not located close to either because in your 82nd, that puts a reasonable option. And then the third one that was identified in the small group was in that KA because it's also located to a concentration of communities, community speakers, but also noting that if there was serious discussion about naming one as a serious option, that we would have to find a location, a new location for the Spanish immersion program. So it created a ripple effect as well, where the idea was Spanish learning program possibly to Kelly, which has a high concentration of Spanish speakers in the area, but you also have a Russian immersion program there that would get bumped. And so one thing that did get called out during discussion group two was looking at the enrollment numbers, that a good majority of the Russian speakers that are enrolled in that program come from out of district. I think nearly two-thirds come from out of the school district. But the idea was we would have to have a serious discussion about moving that program out of district into the area where the students are coming from. So knowing that reality and trying to locate the program as close to the population, trying to serve as best as possible, that's what you try to attend, that it created this domino effect option. So that's why it's listed with the number of colleagues that we need.
Also the Spanish immersion program. The Spanish immersion program at Lentz is very sort of embedded in the school and very much part of the culture of the school. So it's not a simple point of origin.
Clarifying questions.
Well, I just want to reiterate that part of our process is to look at all sorts of ideas, and some of them turn out to be problematic.
Right.
And it's a good thing for us to do to leave us sort of stone unturned. And hopefully for anybody in the public who's listening to this, to recognize that's our process. That just because it's in the minutes doesn't mean we all think it's a great idea, et cetera, that it's our way of carefully going through options.
And I would add to that point, that's why we're trying to be doing a document kind of pros and cons with different options so that we can demonstrate that we know what the trade-offs are, both from listening and our own individual knowledge. So I think that's something we should actually understand going that Spanish embedded in the community, and knowing that building in 2 years could potentially go through a great reconfiguration, thinking about what's down the road for other communities too, so Spanish learning possibly, and then reconfiguring as well, trying to think for that going on.
Yeah, and I'd be curious as to, because the schools are fairly close together, where Spanish learning students are coming from. It could be coming from the Kelly neighborhood.
Okay, if there are no more clarifying questions, so this is the time where you want to take a pause to catch folks up. I'll just let you know you have an hour and 25 minutes remaining to do the work that you want to get done tonight. So.
Overview of some of the issues in those those neighborhoods and in those specific schools, including a history of lateral change, specifically with growth. And in our group, and Scott, you were also in the group, so jump in or afterwards, I'll comment inadvertently. There were discussions about, a lot of discussion about should we create standalone Spanish immersion program, should that be located at Riggler, and should we have two standalone immersion programs at Riggler and Scott, and then have English only programs at Emily's question mark. So to reiterate Scott's point, these are really brainstorming sessions and looking at a specific set of information provided by the CLI department, but not necessarily deep analysis of what each building could hold and where students displaced from any building would end up. So there was some discussion about that, I wouldn't call it analysis. It was really at a discussion level. So these aren't really concrete proposals, but thoughts, things we were thinking through. I think that there was a decent amount of energy around having at least one of those buildings become a Spanish immersion only program. But beyond that, I think that's kind of where we, I don't know where we went beyond that. Scott, you may have a different interpretation.
What I remember is more where we landed was that since there's four strands of Spanish immersion, either school is big enough to hold the students. Both schools, Spanish immersion, and offering whatever services we can for neighborhoods, students living in the neighborhood who didn't want to be part of the group to attend both the school and not.
I think we did definitely have a discussion, and then again did put an acknowledgement as well that potentially there's highly vulnerable students in the neighborhood side, and we did not come up with any type of solution. We didn't look at what would the effect be on families who didn't choose immersion, and that's a big open question. So potentially Somali speakers who chose not to learn a third language, or students with special educational needs who do not want to enroll in an individual language immersion program, or someone who enters after second grade who can not eligible, who may not be a native speaker. So there may be some significant challenges we are now proposing move in a way that we haven't really looked at the impact of. So just wanted to make sure that that's out in the discussion.
So is this accurate? I just pulled up what's in the minutes about that particular. Those were the schools that you mentioned.
Yeah.
And then you said, really acknowledge that this is additional change for communities.
Okay, so I've actually lost track of where you are in your process. Are you wanting to walk through one more? Do you want to have clarifying questions about what you said?
Well, there's also the there's also talk about, there's another great talk focused on the Sheep Joe.
Yeah.
So each is sort of just saying, so maybe this will tell. Each is sort of in the same place as Scott and Riegler, where the neighborhood side is way underserved.
Yes, yes.
And there's a big difference demographically between the neighborhood and the urban side.
Yeah, and that's the part that I remember. I'm just forgetting, like, the moving the guests up there. I know we talked about that there's a lot of positives to the dual language immersion, but that the African American community was not being adequately served or underserved, wasn't effective recruitment and retention in the program. And yet there was benefit. There's, you know, clear benefits after the presentation. So we talked about ways that could happen. So that even if the Spanish immersion was moved to Joseph, that there was still a desire to make that program inclusive, even if it didn't. Trying to channel my
So
there's 17 Kelly kids that class.
Okay, so my understanding is that you want to go into two groups of four. The co-chair will be in each one of those groups. You're going to spend 20 to 30 minutes. I'm going to do a check-in with you just at about 20.
After the small groups are done, we're going to spend about another 10 to 20 minutes each group reporting out. And my understanding, Jason, is that you want each group to consider the entire document.
So what I'm looking, so the goal tonight is by the end of the meeting is to see, where we think, where the language is good in terms of the guidance section, if both sides have amendments to the different parts of the guidance piece, how do we reconcile those? Because the next step is we want to make sure that all of this gets shared with the whole group, because clearly we don't have everybody, and I want to make sure that everyone gets a chance to see the original document and how we would get it tonight, so that folks still have a chance to weigh in again, and then when we reconvene again on the 16th, that we can get to a place where we can, where we believe that we hopefully gain sufficient guidance. So the goal is to see if we can get to the guidance piece in good shape based on what we've individually shared information tonight. You may have identified additional gaps or thought that could improve each of the sections. I know I've got a few ideas as well, and then we can hopefully reach that goal. Strengthen the guidance section that we're reflecting what we know from Saturday and saying, and then this will be identified as a whole electronic between now and the next Tuesday.
And I think, Maxine, what you said about seeing the macro, that's also really important. And so I think there's a real benefit to having participants who weren't in the weeds with us. So you and Katie and Sheila can help find those big overarching statements that you've heard here. That's extremely helpful because, as you know, we all dive down and then having you all here help pull us up to levels of guidance that's a really valuable role in these small groups.
Okay, so I'm going to suggest you guys get into your small groups, begin to work. I'm actually going to check in with you at 7:15. And then we'll see where you are in the small groups.
Okay.
Well, there's some sunlight.
I think there's a chance.
No, but I do think that I presume that there was several statements like that that were not in the voter view of the D-BRAC.
So, okay, I'll next thing we'll get to the D-BRAC.
We talked about.
Okay, so.
These are easy to pass.
And substantial.
Do you know all the people that play purple?
Then this is.
Because we have to judge it.
I'm not even going to bother.
There's something.
And then we come back.
Okay. Next.
But it has to be, the plan is big.
Yeah, thing is big.
Plan is big, the aspects are small.
We can have a sharp still.
Huge.
The right thing to have.
Personal part is big.
And that's almost, as I.
Older than. Number of lots of like this day. Obvious. Part of what you. So it's more or less the same size as my class.
Yeah.
So it's.
Just roll this out. I mean, that was my assumption.
You're asking my question.
This is the position of the.
grade.
The whole school merging program.
Or recommends them to the folks out. Yeah, that I said this whole road up, it's gonna be an automatic comment. Exactly.
So the benefit.
We're talking about having schools having three sections per grade of five. So we have situations where less access to programs, so it creates a more competition. And so what we saw based on that presentation was, if you're going to get a standalone immersion program, you can raise that problem so the schools like each other's bandwidth, because you have eight persons, native and non-native students, or if you're going to have that immersion in the native school, the only way that can be successful for programs to get it is you have equal sections. So that's the, those are the only two parameters we see.
So I'm going to ask both groups to take about 2 minutes to wrap up this piece of the work.
They may not want to be.
and ask everybody to come on back to the whole group. So actually, I have a different thought about how we can get to each other. So the original thought was each group would report out what they came up with, and then we would try and do some work on merging the wisdom from each group. What I might like to suggest is that you guys go first with something, some language that you want to change, and then this group can weigh in on either what they have or they're in agreement with it, and then we'll rotate. So we'll be getting agreement as we go along. So I'm checking in with the co-chairs and the rest of the group. Okay? And am I correct? We're asking Ivan to record when we get to agreement. My understanding is that we're going to have you record at each juncture when we have agreement, changing the existing document.
So you're meaning?
Yes.
Keeping in mind that we are on a really tight timeline.
That's why.
So that's what I can't, yeah, I can't figure out. Where to go.
So what's your description of program?
The programmatic impact of the scenarios.
I think just to clarify, I think with respect to the listening sessions, we thought it was important to acknowledge the things that were said that don't necessarily affect the boundaries. So that's why we suggested adding an additional column. These are things that people said that we're probably not going to be able to do anything about, but we want to acknowledge that they were things.
Okay, so let me just check in with the other group. Do you have any issues with the structure that this group is talking about? Adding that column, making some things clear. Okay, so that's, we've got agreement on that.
I'm sorry, about another column. What was the purpose of the other column?
To acknowledge comments that we had, community comments and concerns that we had heard, but that were outside the purview of the D-BRAC process.
So more of like, these are really clearly enrollment balancing, and these are additional important concerns?
Correct.
And separating the comments into those things?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so Jason, your group, the thing that you have.
So my group focused more kind of strictly on the guidance section itself. So for the section on locations of two or three strands, K5s, I think the language generally was good, but there needs to be an addition here specifically around, you know, what kinds of, you know, staffing programs can you actually get when you have a three strands K5 versus two? You know, what's the FTE gain at a three strand versus a two? So upfront calling out the actual benefits of it.
Is that work for you guys?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so do one more and then go back to the screen.
And then, yeah, so that's
just a question about that. One thing we were wondering is whether you would want us to just say, see attachment, and we would show the white paper that, so you got information on Saturday about programs. It was in a white paper. Do you want that to be repeated in this document? Do you want to just attach to it? Maybe that's technical now. It seems to be thinking about those things because we do have to get it to write.
Yep.
Thank you. Or I wanted to also understand, are you looking for additional information above what you received Saturday to build into this document about her?
So I think the FTE part, yes. So I'm remembering the slide that we had that talked about here's what every K-5 program gets, but the FTE is different depending on how big the program is, and I think that we'd like to see that called out specifically. The specific staffing at X number of students you get, full-time counselors as opposed to part-time counselors. And also a little bit more spelled out just in general with three strands, it makes a difference because you can do X in terms of grouping students during the day, those kind of things.
So we had that discussion as well. The white paper did a great job of explaining a lot. Then there was a discussion around flexibility and other attributes that three strands had that didn't, and we wanted to incorporate that. So I think we concur with the exact same discussion about doing that piece.
So go ahead.
The other thing that we talked about was just clarifying whether three strands meant three strands of the same program or just three strands. So how three strands mean co-located reversion, or does three strands mean which negates flexibility versus three strands of the same program, and to have language in here that clarifies intent.
So I will wager based on one group's discussion on immersion. My guess is we're talking about sole purpose of the three strand is specifically for schools that are only neighborhood schools, not emerging neighborhoods.
I think we definitely agree with you, Michael, to clarify that, because that's going to stand.
So it should clarify that it's three strands of the same program. That's what it's saying.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thumbs up over there. So go ahead, Jason, you're next.
So moving on to guidance number two on configuration of location for access. The first thing we recognized was the first two sentences of that first paragraph can be straight. And then you would start with, you know, the first sentence would be no clear guidance. So that's okay. So it's kind of tangling with the substance of what we're trying to get at. And then other than that, the second part, which is the recommendation piece, there are no substantive changes.
Okay, and you guys agree with that?
I think that part, just being as possible in this section, since there was not a lot of substantive discussion around this, what we're really asking for is guidance so that we can accurately evaluate site locations versus a lot of editorial, because the committee as a whole is not really this conversation.
So why don't you go ahead with your next one?
We talked about this in the two and three strand, and I think we'll back to that, but to the extent that we could, I guess in providing guidance, that we could somehow flush out or provide a concrete picture of what a vibrant three strand school looks like, or two strands of it, maybe really a sense. Not just with numbers and statistics, but like some sort of visual.
So I think that one of the issues about it too is that presentation might include, and this probably not be in this section, Judy, but I'll just state it because it was a follow-on in our discussion. But presentation, excuse me, not presentation, it might be helpful to have things like where are bike routes or where are safe walking routes, and just like bike routes or safe walking routes, or that the school is the destination, but to get gain community buy-in into locations or proposed solutions, that we evaluate not only the metric of proximity, but the visual of how I get my kids to school via X. So we spent a lot of our time talking about communication more than the specific document, but how communication in general with the community works to create buy-in.
I think Sheila said really well is that a lot of families are reacting to what they're losing, but not necessarily understanding of what they're gaining. So to the extent that we can provide a visual of what they're going to in a positive way, it would be helpful.
Jason.
So our next comment is focusing on guidance number three under students receiving special education services. So kind of first, which is to answer one of Judy's questions. So we kind of went for the specific answer that we have the point of, it's basically saying percent of programs should be housed based on the grades that school configuration holds. So, you know, if your building is designated K-5, your special education should be for students who are in grades K-5. And explicitly state that if your spec services are for the grades K-3, it should be located in the building that is in middle school. So getting very clear and explicit about that.
You guys good with that? Or questions about it? Sheila, second.
It sounds fine to me. I guess that, you know, because the issue that you, you know, let's say that we're in a situation where a sped classroom is required for 4K, 5 kids, and it doesn't fit anywhere except in the middle school. Are you saying we don't want that?
Can I just say, we wouldn't do that because then those kids can never, ever be mainstream, and that's discrimination. We don't do that.
Okay.
I would say provide guidance on what you think, what you know well, and what you think is missing based on what you know well. And if there's more that you need to know to get there, say, we need to know more to get there. And include that in what you want to make sure comes in the next step. That would be my suggestion on this section, because I feel like we're in a really technical area that the committee as a whole has not had a chance to be steeped in. I was a little surprised to say that there was missing information, because I didn't know you wanted it. So if it's what you're wanting, tell us what you want. We'll do our best to get it to you. It's not going to be within a week. Okay.
Okay. So, and I'm going to suggest you guys go to 7:55, because that would give you plenty of time for what you want to do next. Do you want Flip to go first?
Yeah. I think I'm going to ask if we what my group, what else we want to share. Because I think we had a lot of, we didn't work our way through the whole document, but we did come up with things like buildings. What happens in the building is not equal to what is in the building. So our language is pretty broad and not very specific. We didn't actually spend a lot of time on the guidance because we felt there were some issues in the prior piece that we didn't get down that far. Well, before we were done, I want to make sure that Alice and Katie.
So this is kind of changing the when it's any student at a school receiving any special education service must be able to remain. We were talking about changing language around there. Can we change it to will instead of must? When we're looking at the language, unless we're talking about if it's individual or if it's when you guys are, yeah. Just a suggestion if we decide to stick with this. Because must sounds.
Well, must is a mandate and will is an option.
Yeah.
And so, are you going
to want that great conversation? If you're going to update that section, please consider not having it be student specific. Because students are assigned, sometimes students are released from those special education classrooms, which you might think is a good thing, but this language says, no, they must stay there. So, that clarification, are you talking about a classroom of students who are assigned there for a program, or are you talking about any student receiving special education services? Like, there's these degrees of difference, and this is a very technical area. There's tons of guidance around it. So I don't want to set you all up in a place that it sounds like you're providing guidance on something that you didn't need to. That's all. So.
Okay.
For the immersion, dual language immersion section. So a couple of things. One is kind of the preference statement that district can have either standalone dual language immersion one or the other, either can exist.
Any thoughts from you?
Okay, just putting that up. A statement about kind of long-term planning is that as the district, you know, looks to expand dual immersion programs, that once you identify a program, that you should be able to identify, as a current home and locate the path from elementary to middle grade to high school, and then you design. So that's what we're thinking. So it's defining a permanent home for it, so not just opening one here and thinking it's going to be. When you announce your opening program, it's like, hey, it's temporary right now and it's location, so when families know it's there, it's actually going to be there. And then also adding in paragraph two, one specifically wanted to acknowledge within the Amato session was the specific fact that families acknowledged that a factor for citing department was that so long it was on the 82nd Avenue corridor, as that frame for why we picked the schools that we did, as that frame of consideration.
So is that clear, you guys, and you're good with it?
And then under the list of schools that we would also put as item label number D, put back in the listing vessel. And then the last part is kind of the overarching statement for current and future programs that the district should do an active and continuous outreach to all communities, particularly historically underserved families, to demonstrate, advertise the program actively so that all families know about these programs.
Okay.
Here's what we think if you were to keep it in the Madison cluster. So there was sort of an ideal and a real, at the same time, they're presented together here.
Right.
A little, and I don't know if that sense of ideal is,
Yeah, it was an ideal for three different groups of students, but then when we looked at Vietnamese immersion and isolation, there were three concentrations, and so three possibilities when you only look at Vietnamese immersion. But when we looked at Vietnamese, when we looked at Vietnamese immersion, and we looked at the maps of concentration of populations together with the Spanish immersion map, and then what Michael told us about Russian immersion, and when we put them all together, we came up with that sort of cascading possibility that we don't have any authority to.
Okay, so I'm going to suggest you bring closure now to the document piece, and then you still need some time to talk about where you're going next. So who of you? So just about the document, my understanding is that what's going to happen now is that this is going to go to the entire committee for them to weigh in on. And I imagine if you look at it also, if something else comes, you'll get a chance to weigh in on it. In order to do what on the 16th?
So what I would like to have happen is two things. If this becomes too complicated. One is the draft that we edited tonight with the track changes, I would like to get sent to the whole group. So that way, not only can they see the original version, but they can also see, in reality, all of the changes we've added, so they kind of see where we left everything as of Thursday night. And what I'm also comfortable with is, as we're looking at this draft, that this all gets converted to Google Docs so we can manage the changes. I would also like to give Ivan just the go ahead to start working on the changes that we've done now and start reconciling that to see where things land, to keep things moving, with the ideal that a formal version 2 of this is the version that we look at as a committee as a whole next Thursday, the 16th. Hoping that the changes are drawn up in place that we're just amending more for a place where we can vote to adopt. That would be, that's kind of the rough timeline. I don't know if it lines up everything, but it's helping me balance moving the document forward. And for those who are not here tonight, it was good to see where we ended things in real time, so they know exactly where we're going.
I think we're going to have a document that we are going to signal agreement on. I would like to make sure that people have at least somewhere between 24 and 48 hours to review it. And so I'm not sure where that fell in the timeline, but to put out when we have a timeline that it has time for people to review.
That fits with what you acknowledged earlier, that you don't have a quorum here now, so people need to see how the changes took place.
Exactly. And to answer the panelist's point on, if the goal is in fact to come to some kind of knowledge and agreement on where things stand on this next week, the ideal is to get version 2, the official version 2 that is for public,
dissemination circulated on Tuesday. So it gives everyone 48-hour window to look at it and review, see if things have been incorporated correctly. And if there's that reason, we'll have enough time so that it incorporates everyone's comments over the weekend and Saturdays. That's my guess. And then also for the members on our meeting, I think Pam and I found a way to make sure that we call all the members who we know who are in town and say, hey, you know, here, expect next Thursday to come out Friday, look at it, look at the comments that we all gave and weigh in on Thursday night, and lay out the same time frame both in email and verbally so that we cover everything.
Okay, so that takes care of your next steps between now and next Thursday. Did you have something that you wanted to say about post next Thursday, what are you guys up to?
If you wanted to acknowledge that next Thursday would be our final meeting of this portion, our goal for that meeting was to have this summary document completed. But we want to spend a few minutes talking about, based on this, we reconvene next fall. The proposal to date has been to reconvene when new data for next September is available, which is early November. But solicit ideas or thoughts around what does reconvening look like. And do we need to, we will need to onboard some new members, so how and when should that happen? And other thoughts around our, reconvening so that we can leverage the work we've done to date and move forward.
So, here's my worry. We wait until November to get new data, and then maps will be wrong. I think that's a really tight timeline for analysis, public comment, redrawing, public comment. As a data geek, if you're basing everything on that last year of data, you're gonna be wagged around like that. I'd rather see maps earlier and then maybe tweet if there's some kind of concerns that come out with data. But have an earlier and longer public process. We know what it's like to be rushed. And especially around late November, December, that's a crazy time for public process. If we could do something where there's something out in late September so that October, early November is a better window for public process, that first hit, I want to throw that out as an idea for response.
Yeah, I think what you guys want to do is, this is exactly why you're sending an interim report to your sponsor. This is the exact kind of thing that you should include in your document. If you have an idea for how you want to reconvene, what you want it to look and feel like, what it would take to get there, please put those things in the most cogent expressions that you can and get it to Carol and staff so that we can be prepared to support you and she knows where you're coming from. To have gotten to the scenario level by now so that you would have something that you would have responded to that was a map, had boundaries on it, program locations. And you would have said, this looks good enough for now, but I'm not, but we need to know, you know, after Ogden Green opens, does it still seem right? Do we know enough, right? So we're not where, quite where we thought we would be, and that may be a reason for adjustment. We use more than 1 year's worth of data when we look at things, but as an old veteran, old hack at this, I can tell you it's really awkward to be facing the public and saying, there's plenty of room for this boundary change at this school because it's only 84% used now. And they're like, no, we had 60 more kids than we expected. Why aren't you taking that into consideration? So there's an awkward period when you're saying something about the future that doesn't really, that was based on what you thought reality would be. And our best guess is beginning of November, we can put those two pieces together, but if you need to do, if you want to recommend additional work prior to that, because we're not quite where we thought we would, again, I encourage you to use this report as your mechanism to do that.
So a preliminary scenario for discussion purposes only, I think that's what this guy was saying we need in order to start the whole process.
So I would ask you, because you've got the experience, how many school surprises are there in an average year that get sustained? Not a 1 year blip, because there's always 1 year blips, we know that.
So Sean and I could probably come up with all sorts of anecdotes or keep going on data and spend a lot of time on that, but I'm not sure that it matters. I don't know. This was our advice to you, and we gave you this advice a couple of months ago, and you can take it or you can modify it. At this point in the night, I'm not sure what else I can say that would, it we'll know when we get there. And I can point you to a few that might blow your mind.
That were all of a sudden not take that is sustained for years and years.
Chat.
So I think this is just so important because figuring out when we're going to meet and if we're actually going to get scenarios is probably the reason it's a hypothetical scenario for discussion purposes. Is almost one of the most substantive things D-BRAC can ask for, and we're having this discussion with 8 people. And so officially, I don't think we're having this dialogue in just us and not everyone because we know what that means. And we have to take responsibility for kicking that off when I suspect that this will be focused on other bigger systemic priorities in the fall. The other thing is this for me is a real test of my personal application of the racial equity lens because on one way, and this is balance of, and this is what I told staff in last month, which is on one hand, I'll read the information, but for me, the core of this is everything has got to be data accurate because if there's some degree of inaccuracy, that is the one thing that will slow us down and will allow everything we can dissect it and say we're doing anything wrong because. And so I want to make sure up front, and I will say this over and over, that whatever staff, we're asking staff to deliver for us, they have enough time to vet it with the best accuracy as possible. 2, I hear Scott's point in that we're moving to a part of Portland that has experienced the most change historically. Some of the most negative, unintended in some cases, unintended impacts. And so on one end, we're looking at early, I want to have as much time to really think through those options and hear from communities as much as possible, particularly from our underserved communities, to really understand the change we will recommend, one that is going to best be a long-term solution for them, particularly for African-American families, our Latino families, who may potentially experience a boundary change, a reconfiguration change, an immersion program change. I want to make sure we have time to ask them and for us to really think through the pros and cons of all.
that's what I say on Scott's point. I get wanting to do something earlier, but I'm equally balanced that with if what we're dealing with is not even remotely based on accurate data, then this discussion is solely for discussion, not substantive. And letting fire under the communities, letting the community right now get excited over something that may not even be substantive possibility is a waste of their time too. And it's going to be serious. So I want to balance that too. So I would say that's what I'm going to do with that. So I would say this discussion is being put forward.
But we did that. I was very disappointed. And so Jason just mentioned it again. Once again, we made the changes that go into effect first in historically disadvantaged communities and people. So that's one of the facts.
So I just wanted to note that I added this statement. This is what the committee will see. Begin the fall process earlier for onboarding and starting to look at scenarios that will be rushed in the fall. Is that a very quick?
I can answer.
I just wanted you to know that's happening, yeah. So that it's going to get out there for discussion.
I think one of the things is, we don't always time, we don't want to make meetings around and have so many things going on. But what we clearly heard in Vernon and other places is, I think a desire to feel connected and feel heard by the district. And that's true despite all the very deep efforts that the district has made. So I think one way that if D-BRAC members are continuing or willing to do is just be present at some of the other school events that are happening at the schools to get an understanding of the schools, to get an understanding of the community, so that when the process does begin in the scenario, it's not suddenly just dropping in. And I think that if people are willing to make that commitment, I would do that. I also just have to say that tonight felt really hard. I know it's been really hard to have the district, but I feel like the level of tension here, that feels hard. So, I just thought we would be a different place right
that this came up in our small group on the idea of continuing to build trust between our community and the community is really an important. That was really one of the big pieces that we focused on to acknowledge the macro environment that we're operating in, and but also understand that our work really affects kids. And that so to the extent that we as both community members and direct members can work to build trust in our work and the communities that we all play in is important, and how we can work with the district to communicate in a way that helps build on that. I think there are some next steps. I would concur that finding ways to bring on new members and continue discussion before November is probably an important thing to do. I also think that accurate data is really important, and so it's really parsing what can be done, what pieces happen when, but to not wait to PD and until November, not only because it, there's a lot of work to be done before we meet the most of the data, in terms of bringing the committee together after a long absence. And I think one of the things we found in this time right now is we were all apart for several months while the process continued without us, and to learn that, continuous improvement, bandwagon, to learn that really long breaks need time to bring us all back together, so to leverage some of the time that we didn't have that data to reestablishing ourselves as a group. So that is some next steps and guidance.
At our 2 minutes after our time.
And so although it feels a little bit like an awkward place to end, we should do that and then work remotely with the idea that we'll come back with hopefully a larger group and quorum next week. Same time.